So, morning, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you, Ian, for joining us. Thank you, Tanya, for joining us. Sorry, Ian, about Mike. I have to say, as a professional musician, the varying tempo of your music is playing with the frequencies in my head. Sorry to say. Great uplifting music, though. Thank you. Yeah, it's a great intro. But you know what was interesting today? That intro sounds a lot slower. For some reason, than what it normally does. Now I'm just trying to get Linda on the screen here.
Hello, I am bit. Here, guys.
What am I doing
am
here?
I don't have any insecurity about this mic. You can be on the screen all night if you like. Here I am. Hello, everybody.
So evening, hello. Tanya. And she said she finally made it, and you are very, very welcome. So,
absolutely.
Anyway, as from today, I am still Michael. I am no longer a female. My female impersonator seems to have disappeared just a little heads up. If you do receive a friend request from me that's medium dash Mike Cavalli, it isn't me.
Isn't the dash between Mike and Cavalli?
I thought it was between...
Hang on, let me just go into it, Mike, because I think the dash, it's medium, and then it's Mike dash Cavalli.
Okay.
So let me just go back into it, because
I mean, that's just important. I don't want to put energy into it, but, you know, Facebook said that they found nothing wrong, and it doesn't go against their standards. Apparently, Facebook thinks that this impersonator is me.
Yeah, so it's... It's medium, then a space, Mike with like a minus sign, Cavalli. Okay? Medium Mike Cavalli. But, Mike, you know, these little trolls, they will expose themselves.
Yeah.
Because they always do.
Yeah.
You know, because of the content that we all saw, the ones who have got friend requests.
Yeah.
So you've got to look at who got the friend requests.
Yeah.
Then you've got to look at, what content did they share before it was taken down?
Yep.
Hackers don't take down stuff because they don't put stuff up there.
Mm.
They're too busy creating 10,000 profiles to try and get everybody's information.
Yep.
So, you know, I think that this is a little bit personal to you and me because of what was shared, because we saw it, you know, and the others who I'm not going to say who else got the friend request, but I honestly do believe that this is somebody who watches us tonight, darling, if that makes sense.
Creepy.
Okay?
Creepy.
Nothing scares me, darling, you know? I've lived through three marriages, you know? I don't get bullied. I don't get harassed. I don't get attacked or stalked.
Yeah.
I don't... allow them to have that power over me. That's the big thing. You know, I've been with abusers. Hello, a guy killed me for God's sake.
Yeah.
If I honestly
thought... He didn't do a good job, Linda.
And that just goes to show you, darling, I fight back, okay?
Yeah.
Because, you know, the big thing out there now is, you know, everyone's starting to get angry. People are starting to wake up to the lies, the deceit. People are starting to realize now that everything that they're getting told isn't the truth. So they're starting to doubt other things in their existence as well. You know, I was even looking at my bottle of water the other day. I love this. It says on the back, where is it? Ingredients, 100% spring water, 100% natural spring water. I'll just show it again.
Mm-hmm.
How do you trust that? Do they put chemicals or GO or some other stuff in this? You know, how do you know?
Yeah.
Because once your integrity is gone, nothing you say can ever reinstate that.
No.
You know?
No.
And that's what these trolls or stalkers or people who make up false profiles about us, this is what they don't realize.
Sure.
Once they've done that, nothing they ever do will bring back that integrity. You know?
Mm.
So whoever it is, I wish you love and light. I hope that you're watching us because you're not affecting us. You know? Wow. It's all good, though.
Well,
it's all.
You know, tonight or today, we got Katerina coming up with the news.
Oh, my gosh. She's gorgeous. And hello, I'm even wearing tonight something in respect out of my heritage of living in America. I'm wearing my San Francisco shirt tonight. There you go. It's got San Francisco on the front.
There you go.
Yeah, because it's, well, darling, we've got a cyclone off our coast and it's, oh, it's so humid.
Right.
You know, it's a little bit cool, but it's really muggy, you know, right. So my hair's just going to go all fizz and curly by the end of it.
Right.
So, with this light on that I've got. So it's all good, you know. So I love what Katerina's doing.
Yeah.
I've got some interesting stuff there about what she said,
right.
You know. Super. But I love making my notes. Yeah.
Good, good.
It's all good, darling.
And, you know, we've got our usual couple of ghost stories, and I think you put the first one up. And then we have the fascinating story of Lindsay Lohan, who's brought herself back, literally dragged herself out of the grave, literally.
Yeah. Well, look at that. Yeah. You know, once you make errors in Hollywood, you know, there's only a few that have ever come back.
Yeah.
And one of them that I love quoting is Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah.
You know, he got right into the drugs, really sure. made a big mistakes.
Yeah.
But he actually came back and look at him, he's Iron Man.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You know, so he's one of the few, like Lindsay Lohan, who actually is trying to make amends and to say sorry for what they've done in the past.
Yeah.
You know, it takes a lot of guts to actually do that.
And it's not,
you know,
easy, a lot of people can't. They're very
it's
unforgiving.
Not especially yeah. in yeah. Hollywood, you know.
Yeah.
They do not ever let you back in because they've got millions at the door waiting for their chance,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
So, you yeah. know, for Lindsay to come back out and she's, mm. you know, I've watched her in The Parent Trap and all those type mm. movies where she played the twins.
Mm.
You know, she was a great kid actor,
mm.
you know. We've got it on DVD. You know, Tashi watched it heaps of times growing up.
Yeah.
You know, she's done some good, and she was in Mean Girls or whatever that one mm. was that she was in. You know, so she's obviously trying. And, you know, I give everybody credit.
Mm.
You know, I like giving people chances. You know, mm. we all make stuff ups,
yeah.
you know.
Mm.
So that's just me with my yeah. life, you know. And I'm willing to oversee what she's done.
Mm.
Like, we don't have to forget it, guys.
Mm.
You don't have to forget what people have done.
Yeah.
But you just give them that chance
yeah.
to see if they are making that change or difference in what they're doing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
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 And
we got the Becky Hobbs story, a big songwriter who received information from an angel, the near-death mm-hmm. experience of Roddy Ryder, who saw the Library of Heaven, and the work of Reggie. So we got quite a bit to get through.
It's all good. So do you want to get into Katerina?
Let's get into Katerina and
let's get into Katerina.
Here we go.
Yay!
Hi, Truth Seekers. How are you doing today? Now, we're here with the news that makes you go, ooh, or simply, why isn't anybody else talking about this? No, 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 why? Enough with the COVID nonsense. No, stop. We want to talk about interesting things. Interesting things happen in California, especially in Hollywood, as we all know. And even though some actors have crossed over, they still refuse to give up that spotlight. Yes, we're looking at you, Mr. Clifton Webb. He was a star who passed in the 60s, and he had starred in about 27 movies, including a Titanic film that came out before the one that we all fell in love with Leonardo DiCaprio and Kate Winslet. So let's talk about him for a minute, shall we? He has a house in Rexford Drive, and that's where he has been seen by other Hollywood higher-ups, such as Douglas Kramer, the owner of the house with his wife. Douglas Kramer is a producer, and his wife, Joyce Heber, is a columnist, and they have both seen Mr. Webb by the pool, a shape of Mr. Webb by the pool, when again he died in the 1960s. So pretty fantastic, huh? And he's also been rumored to be in their bedroom whispering his catchphrase. Well. Rodolfo Alfonso Raffaello Pierre Gilbert and other names, but we know him as Valentino. The term Latin lover was coined for him. He passed in 1926 due to ulcer complications, but he is not forgotten and he loves to make himself known, according to reports. His house, that was a place known as a geometric anomaly, it means that it emits more energy than other places on Earth, is famously haunted by him, as noted by the heiress to the tobacco heiress, Doris Duke, and her butler. She said that she would see Valentino, hear footsteps, and the doors would open and close in the mansion that she bought from him, known as the Falcon Lair. Now, interestingly enough, if you look just to the west of this home, you would find the house that Roman Polanski once owned, that was where the tragic Manson family murders took place. Wow, talk about a hotbed of activity. Now, the house, Valentino's house, that is sadly no longer there. It was demolished in 2006, but you can still see the Latin lover about town. At the Knickerbocker Hotel, for instance, is where he's been spotted dancing the night away. It was a favorite haunt of his to have a martini, and it was even rumored that he would ride his horse there. If he got a little tipsy, the horse was trained to take him back home. And also, interestingly enough, about the Knickerbocker Hotel, it is where the wife of Harry Houdini held seances to see if she could get in contact with her dearly departed husband. From movie legends to music legends, the Knickerbocker Hotel also hosts the ghost of Elvis Presley in room 1016. And that is not the only Elvis sighting, of course. Now, he has been reportedly seen in his Graceland mansion, where it was reported he died in 1977, if you choose to believe that. And his wife, Priscilla Presley, claims to speak to him regularly till this day. And also, actress Paz de la Huerta, who was in the Graceland mansion recording in the basement, says that she felt his spirit go right through her. It gave her pleasure and excitement. And that's not the only famous person who claims to have seen Mr. Presley, the king of rock and roll. Wayne Newton was in a Vegas hotel where Elvis performed regularly. And one evening, while Wayne was performing, he saw someone coming towards him from the balcony. Now, mysteriously, all the lights in the balcony went off except for one, the one that was lighting Wayne. And he claims that the person coming towards him was Mr. Presley himself. I don't know, Heartbreak Hotel just got a little bit happier if you're gonna see the king, I guess, right? That's all for now, my friends, and like always, please stay curious.
Well, I choose not to believe he died in 1977, and that isn't no wacky conspiracy theorist. If you actually do some research and you know who actually Elvis Presley was and why he was in Vegas all this time, and the little clues that seem to always be left, you will know that he didn't die when he said he died. But also these mysterious sayings, there was one guy, the gardener of Graceland, and he's got this beard, and he does actually have very similar features to a very overweight old Elvis. And people start to, oh, look, Elvis still. No, he's not in Graceland. I think he's passed now, actually, but it doesn't work like that. But anyway, there you are.
No, when you fake your death, darling, you can't still live in your own house, you know, as the gardener. Sorry.
Yeah.
So, wow.
But
well,
also,
something
just to let people know that as far as I know, and I haven't checked for a few years, so I'll tentatively say to this date, nobody from the Presley estate has claimed the insurance on his premature death. Why? Because that would be perpetrating fraud if ever it came out. So anyway, I'll leave that with you. Linda, you got some things to say.
Yeah, Douglas Kramer. I just want to reiterate, guys, he's no relation to me. He's with a K, I'm with a C. And just so you know who he was, if you're old vintage like me, he created shows like Wonder Woman with, Linda Carter.
Oh.
And he also did Love Boat, you know, Love Boat, exciting and new. Oh, I used to watch that every night when it used to be on back in the 70s. Now I am showing my vintage here. But, yeah, he was like the spelling of Melrose Place,
right.
Okay? So he created a lot of shows like that. So I just wanted to clarify that. Mm-hmm. Elvis Room 1016, he could still be there. That could have been where he was holding up for 20 years. How do you know?
Yeah.
You know, seriously, it could have been where he was holding up for 20 years. You know, they go into little hotel rooms and just get room service and have all the disguises in the closet so then they can just freely walk around and stuff. But there's a lot of activity at that Knickerbocker Hotel. You know, they've had a lot of shows that go there, you know, like Ghost Adventures and Ghost Hunters, etc. They've gone there. They get creepy EVPs. They get creepy things moving, shadows, lights turning on and off, phones ringing without a cord.
Yeah.
You know, the old dial phones, the round rotary dials, those phones would ring without a cord being plugged in.
I've got one of those. I think I'm going to try and put on next week's show. So, yeah.
Good. Yeah, I think that one was that Jason Hawks guy from they've done one. I know they've got one, you know. He's actually holding the cord and he says, how is this thing ringing? When he's holding the cord to it. And it's ring, 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 ring. Wow. So, yeah, again, Katerina got herself some good stuff there tonight again. Yeah. You know, she's doing an amazing job, darling.
She went
you
a
know,
bit
I
crazy there, didn't she, at the beginning? She went...
But, yeah, she's all good. She's all good. I love her personality, you know. I love her. You know, and you got to remember, Dal, the Yanks are the Yanks.
Yeah.
They have their little moments. You know, I lived over there for a few years. I know what they – I'm starting to talk in the American accent. Oh, my God. Aussie, 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 oi, oi, oi. Here we go. Okay, mate, yeah. I'm back. Give me a Vegemite sandwich and let's go play cricket.
Okay.
Let's go. Where are we going into the next one, darling?
So this is what appears to be a soul release. I've got my – thoughts on this. I think you posted this actually on your website, Linda. But let's have a look. It's a very short one, but let's have a look because I think it's worth posting. So here we go.
Yeah.
That's it. Oh, wrong. Live. Sorry about that. What do you think? That's a pretty fast release. And up? I don't know, Linda. You know, that's what we think of going up or going down. I don't know. I'm indifferent to this.
Well, you know, I've seen a lot of footage where there's been accidents, where people are sitting there filming the accident, you know, with the woo-woo sirens and stuff going because it's just after the accident. And you see all these lights and souls being released. They do have a tendency of going up, okay? You don't just see a soul come out the side of the car and then walk down the road, you know, like Sam Wheat out of Ghost, like what he would have done, exactly, you know, that sort of soul release. So there is evidence that supports that when a soul leaves a body, it actually does go up. But, and that could be why throughout the centuries and the eons of humankind, this could be a suggestion as to why they say heaven is up, because we would not be the first people seeing the soul leaving a body and going up. You know, there would have been people on the deathbed seeing these near death or shared death experiences where they would have seen entities, external or that person who's died, you know, because it could be an angel popping in to take the soul of the living, you know, all this stuff does come into the mix. So the problem here that we have to do is just analyze it to virtually make sure it's not fake. Okay? I watched it. I don't think it's fake. Okay? Myself, I don't think that one's fake. Okay? You know, because there's just too many similarities with other things that I've seen personally. Pity I didn't get it caught on film. You know, I've seen too many apparitions. I've seen too many full-bodied apparitions where it's like you just sitting in front of me. You know, to the point now where it is extremely hard to debunk because they're getting good with their graphics and learning, you know, the CGI or whatever effects that they use, you know, I'm old school, gosh, but you know, there it could be fake, but it is a very interesting topic to discuss, you know.
I mean,
So,
I kind of think that two things here, that the person was shocked, and so the spirit just whoom, left the body, you know, out of this shock thing. Or there was a kind of, yay, I'm out of the body, yay, shroom. It could be that type of
well,
thing.
it could be a lot of things, Mike, you know, because I'm still updating this book, Ghosts Exposed. I don't have a name for it yet, but it's probably going to be my thesis, which was what did I call my thesis? It was called Energetic Transmutation of Consciousness. You know, that was my thesis. But I want to put the word distortion in there because that's why ghosts stay, because there's this distortion of perspective, why they don't go to heaven, you know. So I'm tossing with the name of it. I don't want to make it too techie-techie because I want ghost enthusiasts to want to buy it, obviously. So I've got to put the word ghost in there. But, you know, I'm trying to debunk the science of how this phenomena does work. You know, what happens when we die and why some go to heaven, why some stay on earth. You know, we can debate this for the next eon. But the ultimate thing is that we have to decide, which I think we already have, is that this stuff really does occur. You know, it's the same with near-death experiences now. They can't dispute it. There's just too much scientific proof that suggests that it cannot be drug-induced. It can't be a figment of the imagination of the witnesses, because in some cases there's 100 witnesses to this stuff.
And
You
remember,
know, where they all see
we
what,
only
you know?
need to find one piece of evidence. Those that wish to disbelieve it have to continually try and disprove it.
That's
And
right.
we only need to
You
find
know,
one.
and
And I
that's
think that's
one
been done.
reason, you know, I did a video on my YouTube channel today, Mike. Dr. Linda Kramer is me on YouTube, guys. If you haven't watched me, hello, you're welcome to go. But I did a video today and it was how confirmations work. We always want a confirmation to trust what we're seeing, you know? And I even said in that video today that she tells me to do videos. And it could be for what we're talking about now, where people don't trust. They want to physically see, they want to physically hear or feel a ghost or other explanation, paranormal event. So, you know, it's all right for you to say, hey, I've got Joan, and it's all right for me to say I've got her. But people want that evidence. They want that proof. So then they also believe it.
Yeah.
You know? So it all started because a lady made a comment and she said, if you believe in Jesus, why do you depend on tarot cards? And in the video that I did today, I said, I don't believe in the tarot cards. I don't need them. Yeah. They're there for the viewer. Mm. So then they get the confirmation as a physical card to justify what I'm saying, you know, because I don't need the proof because, hello, she never leaves, you know. She never leaves. Oh. She's always on deck. Yeah. So I'm just grateful that I've got her, you know. I'm grateful that you've got Joan, you know, and other people, you know. I don't know what we do to attract or to acknowledge that these people exist or beings exist around us, but we all have them.
Yeah.
That's the big thing.
Yeah.
We all have the capacity to be like the Mike and Joan relationship or the me and her relationship, you know? And you never find nasty people who have got this because they're negative. Nasty people attract in the negative entities, you know, the D words like Matt Damon, which I don't like saying that word in my house, you know, but so because there are good and there are bad entities obviously out there, you know? Yeah.
Well, you know, before we move on, as people don't give it much thought, I think this audience is quite discerning, so they would. But I'd say anyway, you know, demons are spiritual beings as well, you know? So when people say, I'm spiritual, but which side are you? And it's not black
and
white.
That's exactly right.
You know, there's levels of spiritualism.
Right. Yes.
So, yeah, we just got to define, I think, a little bit more what we mean when we say we're spiritual. But
that's right.
Joanna says, Linda, loving your book. I have a way to go, school holidays, so I'll try to read it all. So there you are.
Oh, Joanne, you're gorgeous, darling girl. Thank you so much for commenting. You know, I don't expect praise. You know, I don't expect feedback. But when I do get it, I love it. You know, it just makes me, it gives me that confirmation that I'm doing the right thing for other people. Yeah. You know,
I want to say something, Linda, that as a spiritual person, if you get praise for the work that you do, which is of a spiritual nature, you have a duty to accept that praise.
Oh, of course.
It's only when you go, because I'm the greatest, that's when it goes wrong. But to accept praise is to raise your self-esteem, raise your self-awareness, and be of service to others.
That's exactly right. But staying humble,
you know,
because I am very humbled by what I do. You know, I'm very humbled, which is one of those traits that I do like about myself. You know, I'm not egotistical about it. You know, I'm sitting here tonight in just a t-shirt. Hello. You know, I like being raw. I like being transparent. I like being, what's the word? Natural. I'll just go there with natural. You know, I don't like doing facades or fake or what's that word I'm thinking? I don't know, because I just pretense. Right. That's the word. I'm not pretentious at all.
No.
You know, I'm just sitting here tonight. I'm in a t-shirt because it's so damn humid here because of the cyclone. Thank God it's gone down south. But, you know, I just say it from my gut, and that's what I hope people appreciate about me, Mike, the same as you, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's we do a marvellous job. Doing a marvellous job. We're touching people's hearts.
One of the great things about being great like myself is that I'm humble.
Absolutely.
Only joking, of course. But that's the
you're gorgeous.
The stupidity.
You're gorgeous. Now, for anybody who doesn't know, Mike and I have been doing these shows now for over a year, okay? You know, we usually talk for about 15, 30 minutes before our shows, and we sometimes talk up to half an hour after our shows. So Please no, you know, Mike and I have, we're starting to build a good rapport, you and me, my old mate, you know.
Okay.
Oh, it's all good. It's all good. So where are we going to
let's go
now?
To the ghost at the cemetery. So
yes,
this
please.
Is an interesting one because it comes from mainstream mainstream news, and again, it's something that I don't think they noticed, as you'll see, and therefore I don't think this was a setup, and I can't see where there would be a reflection. But that's all I'm going to say on it. Let's have a look, see what happens, see what you think.
Yeah.
In October 2021, WNYT News Channel 13 seemed to catch something eerie on live TV. Journalist Sam Hessler was doing a live early morning crossover from Green Ridge Cemetery in Saratoga Springs, New York, when the cameras caught something unusual. Hessler was reporting on the spooky twilight tours that are being run in the cemetery when she seemed to have an encounter of her own. Take a look.
And as you can see behind me here, we have a few gravestones, but what you can't see because it's dark out. And as you can see behind me here, we
It can be hard to spot at first, but if you slow it down and brighten the image, you can make out a transparent figure moving from right to left in the background.
As you can see behind me here, we
Green Ridge Cemetery is full of bizarre stories of murder and mishap. One famous grave belongs to Charles Dode, the man who first proposed multiple time zones for the railway network in the United States in 1869. In 1904, while crossing a road in Saratoga, Dode was struck by a train and killed instantly. Some say his spirit lingers in the graveyard to this day. So what did WNYT's cameras actually capture? Could it really be a ghost? Given the lengthy history of the cemetery and the haunting stories attached to it, it certainly does make you wonder if this old graveyard really is haunted.
As you can see behind me here, we
You know, at first I thought that perhaps between the camera and her, there was like a screen that would stop wind muffle and stuff. But then I think that entity, if you like, goes behind one of the stones. So I have to put that theory to one side. I don't know what's happened to my hair in between there, Linda. But anyway, so what do you think?
Well, the first thing is, you know, I like seeing reporters when they're on camera. Generally, reporters stand in the middle of the shot.
Right.
However, in this one, she's standing off to the side,
right,
which I think they've done deliberately, so you can see that depth of the tombstones behind her.
Right.
So it's not just her with this big one just behind her in shot. Yeah. So they want that depth to show, oh, we're in the scary cemetery at night type effect, right? But they weren't expecting what happened.
Right.
So generally, I would have debunked that and said, sorry, that was a car going past my house. Did you hear that? Oh my God.
You have cars out there in Australia.
We don't just ride kangaroos around on the street like people think. No?
Fake news.
Or
they're giving me fake news. But anyway.
That's right. We do have cars here. Okay. So,
what's that, Skippy? She's not telling the truth. Okay.
Hang on, I've got to do the hands. Okay. All right. So, okay, first thing, I'm going to say it. I think they did it deliberately that she was standing offside so you could see that depth of the cemetery to give it that ooh feeling, okay, of that sensationalism of being journalists, right? Secondly, when it's running across, you can actually see an arm come out. So it's as it's running, it does this like that effect. So it's running, okay? So it is human. I'd say this is a human running somewhere because they didn't pause to tell us, hey, I'm late for the bus or I've got to get to work today. That would have been nice if they'd just paused and said, oh, can you give me a lift? I'm running late for work. Yeah. But no, there was nothing there. So, you know, they had obviously good cameras, so they would have had good microphones. Pity they didn't get an EVP. They may have, but they just didn't release it, yeah. You know, because they don't want to scare too many people.
Yeah.
But I really do believe, you know, the way she looks off to the side here and it runs past this way, you know, cameramen and reporters, they don't do that unprofessionalism when they're doing their reports.
Right.
Oh, look at me here and it's happening there. You know, that's for magicians with the sleight of hand type stuff. Reporters don't do that. So I honestly believe that's true. Yeah, it's running. You can see arms in there if you slow it down.
Yeah.
It's humanoid. Yeah, I've seen look, too many of those to know.
Let's have a look one last time, and if anyone's got any comments, just put them down there. We'll put them up. So.
In October 2021, WNYT News Channel 13 seemed to catch something eerie on live TV. Journalist Sam Hessler was doing a live early morning crossover from Greenridge Cemetery in Saratoga Springs, New York, when the cameras caught something unusual. Hessler was reporting on the spooky twilight tours that are being run in the cemetery when she seemed to have an encounter of her own. Take a look.
As you can see behind me here, we have a few gravestones, but what you can't see because it's dark out. And as you can see behind me here, we
It can be hard to spot at first, but if you slow it down and brighten the image, you can make out a transparent figure moving from right to left in the background.
As you can see behind me here, we have
full of bizarre stories of murder and mishap. One famous grave belongs to Charles Dode, the man who first proposed multiple time zones for the railway network in the United States in 1869. In 1904, while crossing a road in Saratoga, Dowd was struck by a train and killed instantly. Some say his spirit lingers in the graveyard to this day. So what did WNYT's cameras actually capture? Could it really be a ghost? Given the lengthy history of the cemetery and the haunting stories attached to it, it certainly does make you wonder if this old graveyard really is haunted.
As you can see behind me here, we have
So there you go. I mean, Tanya says, I used to visit cemeteries often, always a lot of activity and energy there. Well, you know, I think there's a lot of weirdos in cemeteries. I was sitting down at the bench and somebody came up to me and said, morning. I said, good morning. I didn't think anyone could see me. She ran off for some reason. Strange, strange people. But yeah,
you're good, Mike. I love that.
There are some, some naturally, you know, in London, some of the cemeteries, when I used to walk through there, you know, the gravestones, you know, 1750, 1720, 1680, you can barely just see the right. I mean, what history there is going through those cemeteries. And not all
and,
bad or uneasy spirits, you know, but.
And I love it how they always have to show, like, one person famous that's in that cemetery. There could be 1,000 graves there. Yeah. Who could it be?
Yeah.
You know, but they always have to say, oh, this person died and he's buried there. Yeah. Is it him?
Yeah.
Well, that could possibly be him. Yeah. But unless they start talking or showing themselves, then you're not going to know, are you?
Yeah.
Tanya? I like going out to the Goodna Cemetery. Goodna is good because I've got the asylum there. Yay! You know, Goodna Cemetery in Brisbane, it's about a 15-minute drive from my house.
Yeah.
If ever you're down my way, Tanya, let me know because I'd love to take you out there because Goodna is one of the – it's a private cemetery. So people just – you don't pay like a block like usual where they're all lined up.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no, like, rows or anything and you can build whatever, you know, people have houses. There's other people in these, like, round things. you know, all the cemetery, all the tombstones are different, which I love it there, you know, because I've gotten some good EVPs, etc., out at Goodna. So I think I'm going to do a ghost tour out there. Oh, God. You know, God, well.
You know.
Maybe next year.
If anybody's interested, Google Highgate Cemetery in London. There's a lot of famous people there, notably Karl Marx and George Michael. And like the lady who was in The Omen, I think, that died. And, you know, that we had that article a few weeks ago, and they had to move her because of grave robbers. Pretty much the same with George Michael. They've actually put him in an unmarked grave, I believe, because of people just being so disrespectful. You know, so, but it's a fascinating cemetery. So.
Oh, yeah.
So anyway, that's all I wanted to say on that. But it really, you know, if ever you make it to London, you can do a tour of Highgate Cemetery.
Yeah. And it's well worth
doing it. Yeah, I mean, you know,
Tanya's just mentioned to Wong.
They're absolutely crazy at Highgate Cemetery. There's in Highgate Village where George Michael's sister had a little fashion shop in the little village, and there's a little green there. And I mean, to this day, I think it's still just bombarded with flowers of George Michael because he didn't live too far from there.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a kind of an obsession that people have when someone dies, you know. I mean, send me the flowers when I'm alive. So I'm no good to me when I'm dead type of thing.
I just want to clarify, Mike, you just said a green.
Yeah.
That's like a park, guys, if you're watching from America or US or Australia or anywhere else that's not in Europe. It's like a park, okay? That's what they call a green or a common.
Yeah.
You know, when I lived in the UK, I lived near a common. Yeah. So it was a common open area where people could go and congregate, have play ball and stuff, like a park.
Yeah.
Okay, so in the UK, it's called a common. Tanya's just mentioned To Wong. If you look at my group, Dr. Linda Kramer Paranormal, that ghost photo on the top with the UFO, that is a real ghost photo which I got at To Wong back in 2017. I think I took that in December. So that's about 3 or 4 years ago that I got that photo. It has been verified. It is a real photo of a ghost because he's got no body for a start.
That's pretty ghostly.
That's a pretty good idea that there's something going on here, Mike.
Yeah.
You know? So To Wong, I love going out there. You know, we can go out there through the day, Tanya. You know, I like going out there through the day. I've had a lot of activity there through the day because it is so big. You know, you hear music playing. You hear kids playing, you hear people talking just behind your back, so you, like, turn around expecting to see someone there and there's nobody there. I have seen apparitions out there through the day, so you don't have to just go there at night time, you know. So To Wong, I don't know if it's – it is government-owned. I don't know if we've got to – if the unjabbed are allowed there.
Because they're dangerous to the dead. But –
I'm glad I wasn't eating breakfast cereal at that point because you would have just had Cocoa Pops all over the screen moment. I'm dangerous to the dead.
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's move on to Becky Hobbs. This is a lovely story.
Let's go and have a look at Becky.
An angel amongst us. She's, just to give you the heads up, she is apparently a famous songwriter. As you'll see, written some songs that Alabama have taken on. And she had this premonition. So let's go over and see what she has to say.
Yeah, have a look at it.
I was walking home from school on a cold winter day.
The song Angels Among Us, performed by the renowned group Alabama, is a moving tribute to the power of miracles. But the story behind the writing of this song is a miracle in itself. Songwriter Becky Hobbs had composed hits for stars like Conway Twitty, Emmylou Harris, and Glen Campbell. In 1994, Cashbox magazine named her Independent Country Music Female Artist of the Year. Her biggest dream came true when Alabama took Angels Among Us to the top of the charts for over a year. But that dream began with a nightmare.
I started having premonitions that I was going to be in a bad vehicle accident. And this would happen to me shortly before I'd fall asleep. You know, when you lay down and you're getting ready to go to sleep and you're sort of drifting into a dream, I'd sit up in bed and I'd be sweating, my heart would be pounding, and I would have a feeling of despair.
Becky didn't realize that her nightmare was just the first of two powerful premonitions. The second would occur a few weeks later while preparing a cake for her birthday.
I was stirring the batter and something took a hold of my elbow and pulled me out through my hallway out into my front yard. It was a feeling like, you don't question this. You go out in your front yard. I knew there was something I needed to know. I didn't hear a voice at that point, and there was his force, and I followed it. And I just went, what are you trying to tell me? This loud masculine voice said, this may be your last birthday. And I'm thinking, may. The key word is may. This may be your last birthday. This is something I can prevent if I'm careful.
Becky didn't have to wait long to act on her instinct. Her premonitions came true the very next day as she and her band returned to Nashville from a benefit concert.
We were stopped at a four-way intersection, and I looked out the window of the van. There was an 18-wheeler just barreling towards the intersection.
Her nightmare returned in a flash.
I got that same sick feeling that I had had in the premonitions. My heart started pounding. At that moment, I felt our driver's foot lift off the brake, and we started moving forward.
Becky screamed, and the driver swerved the vehicle. A second later, and everyone in the van would have been killed. But miraculously, they all walked away. In time, Becky realized her life had been spared for a reason.
It all happened so fast, but it was later that I put the pieces together. Sometime after the accident, I wrote down the title, I Believe There Are Angels Among Us, in my notebook. I started working on it, and I had a melody happening, and I had the first line of the chorus, and I had pretty much the sketch of the chorus. Sometimes when you're writing a song, you're rocking and you feel like you're on top of the world, and you feel like, yeah, I like this. This song was more like we were in awe of what was happening. We were humbled, and I felt very small when I was writing it. I felt like it was a gift and that I was fortunate to just be one of the channels for the gift.
Someone lights the way with just a single ray of hope. Oh,
I believe there are angels among us.
When the members of Alabama heard Becky's song, they too were deeply moved. And today, Becky Hobbs looks back at her premonitions and near-fatal accident with a miraculous sense of purpose.
I do think that one of the reasons why I'm still here, so I could write the song Angels Among Us. Because the song has given so many people so much and has given me more than I ever dreamed anything could give me. It has just been truly a blessing in my life.
Show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of.
And there you have the songwriter's favourite companion, a cup of coffee with them at all times, a necessary partner.
Yeah.
Interesting. You know, Linda, it does bring up the question again, why have some people been given the opportunity to correct something that might finish their life early? Was it a life contract? Was it they were heading out of their life direction? Or what? What can it possibly be? Or do we all get this, but most of us don't listen? I mean, it could be a combination of all things.
I believe it's a combination of everything, Mike.
Yeah.
But most importantly, you said a word in there I really do like, life contracts. Mm-hmm. We do have contracts, and we can write in sub-clauses and entry and exit points. Mm. You know, why are some kids born premature? Mm. Why are some kids overdue? Mm. You know, so we can have entry as well as exit points. How many near misses do people have where they think, oh, my God, I nearly died today? Mm. You know, that's an opportunity for us to leave this life if we wanted it to.
Right.
But then, you know, somebody said to me only a few months ago, they said, Linda, was your NDE part of your life contract? And I had to sit there and think about that, because now I am a totally different person.
Yeah.
Thank God, you know, thank God that now I have looked at who I was before 2001, and, you know, she was a kid. You know, she was a total kid. You know, I was mid-30s. I was still an idiot. So I got this opportunity where I could start really assessing who I was as a person. So did I put that into my contract where I would have that, like, not a wake-up call or a epiphany moment, but just an opportunity to put my life into perspective and say, where do you want to be next? Yeah. You know what I mean? Mm. So, you know, we all have life paths. Mm. We all get opportunities to live out those paths. So some of us need that nudge, you know? Mm. Let's just say I have a life path where I'm going to be feeding millions of homeless people.
Right.
And I'm at school and I want to get into science or something. I don't know. They'll do something, an opportunity to correct that path.
Yeah.
So then, you know, we may get involved with a person who abuses us, so we end up in a women's shelter or a homeless place where we then start working with them. You know, I've lived in a women's shelter before when I left my first husband. You know, my friend Rebecca, who I don't usually mention, she lives up on the Sunshine Coast. I actually ended up living in her house. In between the 14 times of going back and forth to America, because she saw something in me where she invited me to live in her house with her rather than to stay in the women's shelter.
Yeah.
You know, so I am honored, blessed, and highly privileged that I got that opportunity to live in a homeless shelter or women's refuge, it was. Because I learnt a lot there, and it was a preemptor. Can you handle this so when you die in another year, you'll be able to understand, see how it all falls into place when you look back in 2020 vision? So I honestly believe that I did write in my life contract that I would be in that opportunity to where I had to look out for other people and, you know, I was driving women to the dentist. You know, one lady, she got bashed by her husband, lost front teeth. So she actually wanted me to sit in the dentist with her.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, you know, while he's drilling in her face. So that taught me a lot about compassion. It taught me a lot about humanity and humility. It taught me so much about understanding what, you know, because I had a very I was very sheltered growing up,
right.
You know.
Yeah.
My dad was Air Force. We travelled around a lot. I went to the UK. Very, very sheltered life. So that was a really big grow-up lesson to see how I would react in those situations, you know. Yeah. So, yes, we do have clauses. We have sub-clauses. We can have our ins and out, Mike. Why does it happen to some and not others? Well, some are on their path and others aren't, you know, and it all depends on what we have assigned to ourselves as a life lesson in this existence, where, you know, whether we are so far off that track that they virtually have to kill us to get us onto the right track again, you know?
And so, of course, you know, in this case with Becky Hobbs, there's this, if you like, self-fulfilling prophecy. She has to write this song for this world-famous band, Alabama, to sing.
Yeah,
to get this message out to the multitude of people.
And here we go with synchronicities. Alabama was obviously doing other recordings. They were doing shows, tours, blah, blah, blah. So when she wrote that song, it was the perfect timing where they picked it up and they recorded it and made it famous.
Yeah.
What if they were on a 6-month tour?
Yeah.
And she's written this song and she just says, oh, well, I'll just put that in the back of my cupboard.
Yeah.
So the timing was impeccable.
Yeah.
All these synchronicities came into play.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've often said when we have a deja vu moment, that's a pivotal moment where we're actually remembering it from our soul level. It's a doozy, okay? Yeah. It's a doozy. But let me just go there for a minute. When we have deja vu, oh, my God, I've done this before. We haven't actually done it in this life.
No.
Because in our soul's existence, there is no time.
Yeah.
So we're actually remembering it from our soul's perspective.
Yeah.
That's what I think is deja vu.
Yeah.
Because if you look at instances of deja vu, there's always a pivotal message there. Mm. You know, you're going through some stress or job interview, or you're doing something, creating something, where you get this deja vu moment and you think, oh yeah, I've made this cup of coffee before. It's not so much the cup of coffee that you're making in your kitchen. It's that situation that you're going through at that time where your soul is letting you know, bingo, bing, 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 warning, warning, Will Robinson type thing. You know, so it does get a little bit deep, you know, for a lot of people.
And it looks like we've just been cut off again. Some people may be able to hear us, but the viewing goes down to zero right now. But we'll continue because this will go up on YouTube.
Well, we are having a storm here too, Mike. There's thunder and lightning out, but my internet's still secure.
Yeah.
I always go to hotspot before
this,
I start.
This, I think, is another infringement of copyright. We'll carry on anyway.
Yeah, you're right, because we've lost all our viewers.
Yeah.
Let me just go over. Yep, so who are we going to watch now, darling? We're going over to Lindsay Lohan?
We're
going to
go to Lindsay Lohan because this is a fabulous story. This is one where obviously the press loved reporting her demise and she's been to hell and back. Yes, it's of her own doing and she admits this. But this is a great story, and it's actually how ayahuasca actually helped her to get herself back. So while this is running, I'm going to send a message to people. So here we go.
Watching this series, I just know how I felt at that moment, and I can relate to that girl, which sounds kind of crazy, but I'm like, oh my God, this is like, looks, this is really sad. Like, who's helping her? And no one knows what's going on in my head at every second because I'm constantly thinking. Like, my mind does not shut off. Which the only time it does is when I start doing meditation or I put music on in my headphones. And here's the thing, it's like, even if it's not my intention to lose everything I'm now working for, that's what this addiction will do to me. Now I'm in a place where I've learned it and I know little things that I can do and people that I could surround myself with or not be with. I blocked so many people on my phone. I worked with a shaman I did a cleanse.
These are crazy.
Did a really eye-opening experience of ayahuasca. It was really intense. And I saw my whole life in front of me. And I had to let go of past things that I was trying to hold on to that were dark in my life. And physically, I felt it when I had this experience. Like, I saw myself die. It was insane. I saw myself being born. And that, I feel different ever since that. Just being okay with, you know, the wreckage of my past and letting that go and starting fresh. And it's just, I'm in a good place and I don't want to mess with that because it feels good. I'm happy. the biggest thing that I've learned from this experience. I have that like fire back in me.
It's really powerful.
I have that aggressiveness that I used to have to keep going, and that adrenaline rush that I get from doing good things and being happy and feeding my soul again. And that feels pretty incredible. So that's, yeah, thank you.
So there we go. What do you reckon?
Okay. Ian's just messaged me on Messenger. He can still see and hear us, but he can't comment. Okay? So we are still out there, Mike.
Okay.
Okay, so we've still got people watching. Thank you so much for anyone who stayed. Yeah. Please know that something's happened. But thank you so much to Ian for letting us know that you can still see us. But, yeah, we'll keep going with our show as usual. Okay. Yeah, so Lindsay Lohan. You know, she had a very, very turbulent first couple of years of her life, you know, pushed into modeling, pushed into movies. She, you know, and you look at any child
abused,
actor, Mike,
in
you
other
know,
words,
they,
yeah.
They, absolutely, you yeah. know, I don't want to mention any names, but look what happened to a lot of them. They're, Home Alone kid, yeah. Blue Lagoon girl, you know, what was her name? I don't know. She was Brooke Shields. Thank you so much. You know, Macaulay Culkin, that's the other one. You know, you look at these poor kids, they don't get that opportunity to experience life as a kid. So when they end their career, you know, their child careers, usually about 14, 18 years old, they're sitting there and they've got no friends, they've got no social interaction skills, they've got no communication skills. They think, oh, I'll go to university now with that, I've made some money. Yeah. But they don't even go through with that because they don't know how to interact with their lecturers or the other yeah. students because they've had this privileged lifestyle. So I actually give her some credit, darling, you know, yeah. for coming out yeah, and actually, yeah. you know, letting people know the struggle that, you know, look at Britney Spears with yeah. what she's coming out with now, yeah. you know, yeah. with what she went through.
Yeah.
You know, I honestly believe Britney Spears, all that was with her ex, that Federer guy that she got involved with, you know, he wanted her money. Let's just go there. He wanted her money.
Mm.
So, of course, her parents had to say, what can we do so he doesn't take it because they're married?
Mm.
Let's intervene and keep it all for her
yeah.
so she can get rid of him out of her life and then she can have it all back again.
Right.
But then greed came in. They never gave her anything. They were controlling her, you know, listening devices, you know, and they'll defend that and say, oh, well, the listening devices were to make sure that she wasn't talking to him anymore to yeah. get him back, yeah, yeah, you know, because yeah. they ultimately were trying to protect her, but ultimately it all went in legal fees.
Yeah.
So it doesn't always pan out, you know, unfortunately.
Yeah.
You know, and I always say, you know, you got to let these kids yeah. do what yeah. they want yeah. under their free will,
yeah.
you know, because most of these, you know,
Linda, I'm not advocating people should use ayahuasca, but my experience is many people have resolved issues using this by going obviously in that altered state and allowing them to go back to a point that their subconscious yeah. Can recognize, that their conscious yeah. mind doesn't, and they can resolve the issues there. And just yeah. to clarify everything, the people that I do know have done this here in Austria, because of some crazy laws, it's something like it's legal to buy it but not use it, you know, something stupid like this, typical Austrian laws.
Yeah, it's like fireworks here in Australia, you can buy them but you can't set them off.
Yeah, so you know, here the guy, the shaman, you've got to stay with him over the weekend and you've got to fast on the first day, and
yeah.
for 2 weeks prior, you've got to eat certain food. So it's not just a case of drinking it and you inevitably throw up
yeah.
with this and then go into this altered state. If it's done properly, there is a process to
yes.
this. So
yes, that's right. So you've got to commit to the whole ceremony and yeah. not just the day of it.
No.
Yes.
Yeah,
I know a few people here in Australia. They do it down on the Gold Coast. There's a clinic, like a spiritual clinic down there where you go and stay there for a week. they feed you all the food first, you know, so you, it is quite expensive because you've got to stay there for a week and they supply everything for you for the week.
Yeah.
You know, but it's mind-boggling, the experiences, because as we all know, we all have our own individual experiences with any sort of drug or alcohol or other addictions or, you know, anything else that we can do. But, you know, so you just can't go in there saying, oh, yeah, this is the end result of what's going to happen. You've got to take away those expectations because, you know, it's like an NDE. Some people have the hell event and other people go to heaven like I did, you know. So you've got to be aware of what you could get involved with, you know, when you do these sort of things.
Yeah.
But I give her credit, you know. Ayahuasca, it is one of those critical alternate medicines that, you know, they're trying to debunk, you know, because it is a, you know, things can go wrong while you're in that state. Obviously, it's not like hypnosis. You know, things can go wrong when you're under hypnosis. You know, people have heart attacks and die because of what they're seeing and experiencing. So you've always got to know that there could be some serious side effects to these techniques that we can do. Okay.
I mean, a good shaman, if he sees it's going wrong, will call them back and say, come back over here with me, go this way, go ignore that, just turn around and can get them out of that place. That's why you've got to have a very experienced shaman when you're doing that kind of thing.
That's right.
It clearly has worked for her, and she's turned her life around, and voila, good for her.
That's right, darling. So, absolutely, good on her. You know, it's her free will what she does. You know, that's what I was trying to say before. But, you know, these kids, they, you know, they've got to have free will to do what they want, you know, and I'm glad that she's out there now. And she's, you know, she's still looking great. She wasn't looking so good there for a few years. But now she's obviously cleaning herself up. And hopefully she does do the Robert Downey Jr. And come back and start again, you know. I'd like to see that for her.
Good.
Wow.
Okay.
Alrighty.
Time's running on. Should we let's go and look at the Rodney Ryder NDE?
Absolutely.
He saw the libraries of heaven. That's all I'm going to say. Let's just have a look at this, and sadly no one can comment, but there you go. We know you're there. Here we go.
My face struck the steel ladder as it struck the steel barge. Basically, that ladder has been impressioned into my body. About the 45 degree angle looking down as I was coming down is when I felt the pop. So I went into, again, the blackness, total darkness all around, conscious, yet not worried, not, you know, am I dead or, you know, emotion. It was just a calm feeling. Again, I always describe it like someone giving you a warm blanket, wrapping yourself around, and you were just there in the moment. No time, just there. But all of a sudden, a split in the darkness. It looked like it was just like a lightning bolt coming down and then opened. And then I just felt myself working towards and going through. The initial tear looked like a lightning bolt, like it was open, and then it just slowly widened, opened into like a portal, you could say, or open circle of light. And then as I came through, I found myself out onto a gravel path in a tree grove. Very much like a forest, tight weaving, sort of smaller trees, like small maples. Almost felt like bamboo in a way, too, how tight the grove can be around. And it just led out onto a mountain ledge. From the mountain ledge, I looked down and I was looking upon a three-tiered mountain meadow. It was earth-like, but it wasn't earth. Like, when you're generally walking around, you suddenly see part of your nose, you know, and everything else. Unfortunately, here, it's just more of, again, a consciousness. If you can say, imagine maybe I was an orb or whatever, just going out, I wouldn't see any reference to the body. Everything was 10 to 20 times plus in depth of color, of clarity. The sky, a little bit different. Again, I saw mountain ranges around. I was actually looking at the three tiers from the ledge. So the lower section of this mountain meadow, I saw others, is how I describe it. Maybe thousands. And they were just moving around. And then I proceeded to look, towards, again, the upslope, the second level of the meadow, and thereupon the second tier was the most spectacular rectangle golden portal. And everyone keeps talking a portal. I'm like, yes, like you see on Stargate or whatever else, there was a rectangle portal. The sheer shine of it coming off, it was just, I'm trying to find the words, a shining light, just a golden light just all around it. Forms, others, there was form, different forms. Place of holding or rest or whatever, it was just where they were there. But they were interacting with each other, several of them were. I was like an observer. From there, on the third tier, what I would describe as a jeweled marbled halls. Just spectacular streams of gold and silver sparkling, jewels, gems. Some people call it the Library of Heaven. Some people call it by other names. It had its own glow around it. Then my fixation was on this most beautiful green, lush grass field that was going amongst these other tiers. And then I found myself gliding down amongst it. There was a feeling of contentment and love that I cannot describe. Laying down amongst the grass, the contentment, a peace, a recharging. The love, and everyone talks again, they describe about the light. Everything was the light. Everything that I saw, I felt, was the light. But it encapsulated you like a liquid love. A love of a child times a million. I have two daughters, and I still cannot love them to compare to that same love that I felt. And it felt like I was a recharging battery. And as I was looking through the grass, I was looking through the grass stems at a microcellular level. I was watching cells move around with all the little liquid moving amongst the cells. It was just, you were all knowing. People talk about that all knowing, that all seeing part, and it's where you were all connected together. It was a piece of just serenity. And but again, you felt like you were just being recharged through this event. But as I was contemplating all this, part came into me going, why am I here? I feel like I snuck in. And then through the grass, watch the silver shiny mist come through. And that's when they came forth. I had an experience where I had the most vibrant, beautiful, bluish, white, shining light. Forms, light beings, and they surrounded myself. And they were human form, but they were more spindly. I don't have a recalling of what they said directly to me. It's more of what I've experienced after this event, of certain knowings that you almost get like flashbacks where you see their face or you see something they might have discussed with myself. And now it becomes a almost like a pressure wave. Best way I can describe it is if you take two opposing magnets and you push them together, you get that compulsive pull to either to go forward or to, if something's right, you get that feeling. Again, I don't know how long I was with them, but all of a sudden I was like drawn up into a small little thing, and it was like loaded onto a slingshot and then aimed down a straw. And I'm going down this, best way I can describe, is a rainbow vortex in a small straw. And feet first, if how I would describe it, because I am looking back upon the tallest light being. And I am going, no, 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 please, no, I do not want to leave, no. And I'm still watching that. I'm going down. I am still watching this being, looking upon this being. And then as I'm going, I would describe halfway down. Again, no noticing, but all of a sudden, I watch as half my vision goes, starts to go blurry, and then closes up on what I would describe as my right side. And I felt this tremendous pain start to enter as I'm still going down this vortex. Pain, agony, I mean, just rippling, crushing pain. And that's when I proceeded to fuse, not wake up, but fuse into my physical body on this side.
Interesting choice of words that he fuses into his body. Always the pain comes back when they come back to the body. Always the pain, which is a shame, really. But what are your thoughts, Linda?
I'm just, you know, I love it when I hear so many similarities. You know, in my book, 5 Years in Heaven, I explained what the chairs are for, because we don't have to sit down because we're not physical, tired, you know. We don't need rest.
Sure.
But they're there for contemplation, so we can pause and be aware of what's going on around us with others. And, you know, for him to call it the microcellular level, that's not the words I use in my book, but I say it like I became the other person because we were one, okay? So he's saying it in his own definition of his own interpretation to make words. I love it how he mentions the blue orbs, you know? How many people have seen these blue orbs out there? You know, it's not something that's been highly advertised with near-death experiences, but obviously there's a lot of people that see the blue orbs like I did. What are they? Where are they from? What do they do? I don't know, because they didn't communicate. They obviously didn't communicate with him either. So there's another similarity that I'm loving here. You know, do I believe his story? Absolutely. You know, I saw, you know, not that I mentioned it in my books, but, you know, I was in these buildings and there was just rows and rows of books, but we don't need to read them, because we already know what every word of every page of every book is. So I don't even know why they're there, but it's a like a figment of our imagination or a part of our perspective. Or is it the records of all our lives? You know, like the
Akashic records.
What do they call them?
The Akashic records.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. That's right.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
it could be those.
The halls of learning could be for people that, you know, maybe still hold a little bit of that earthly consciousness when they're on the other side. And perhaps they feel more comfortable reading rather than...
That's exactly right.
Yeah,
but I never saw anybody reading any of the books up there, Mike, you know, so there's obviously a purpose for it, but I wasn't privy to that. You know, I don't want to even fathom how much of heaven I saw. You know, I was up there for a long time and people say, oh, did you see all of it? And I say, well, I don't know. How far is that land going past those trees? What is over there? You know, I only saw what I was supposed to see. That's how I say it. I was only supposed to see what I saw, you know. So I love it when people like Rodney come out with their own versions of what they see, because it just adds value to the fact that we don't die. It adds more credibility to the fact that there is life after death. And it also gives that belief that this materialistic body that I now inhabit, she's coming back again, you know, because we can. Because we already have. Because there's no time up there. You know, it's a big doozy, Mike. It really is.
It's worth pointing out as well that, you know, as a medium or a channel, or as a psychic, we are not privy to all the information that we impart on when we're doing a reading. Sometimes it's because we don't have a good link and we just can't get that information. Sometimes it has to be said that there are many who are not good enough to do it, but do their best. And other times it's simply not for us or the guide or ever to tell us to impart that information, because you got to find that out yourself. But as a channel, we can give you a hint in the right direction. So
that's exactly right.
So if you do go for a reading, this is one of the reasons why things maybe are not so clear, and one of the reasons why it asks more questions than answers when you actually go for a reading. But anyway, you know, Linda, we are running out of time because I've got a German lesson.
We've got to get on to Reggie. Yep, we're going on to Reggie. Let's go have a look at Reggie.
Let's see what he has to say. Here we go. A great medium, this guy, actually. Here we are.
I already feel like I know you, which is weird.
You do? I feel like I know you. That's what I'm saying.
I am a psychic medium. Mm-hmm. So what that means is I connect with people's loved ones, as well as I have ability to connect with you as well on an empathetic level. So what that means is I can feel what you feel and tell things about you.
First of all, don't use big words, empathetic and all that. When you're with somebody who got these abilities, you try to clear your mind, because I don't need you to know what I'm thinking.
Okay. As I was connecting with you and feeling your energy, there was someone coming to me, and she definitely feels like a mother figure, because I feel like she's standing above you. She has a very strong spirit. A short woman. She didn't seem like a tall woman at all.
Yeah, she's
But she always kept her hair cut short.
Yep.
Kind of like in curls, kind of like my hair.
Yeah, it was always curly.
And you take a lot after her. Like, you're like her mini me.
Too much credit, but go ahead.
I feel as if her passing would have been, if it was like after or near your
birthday. Yes, you're better than them other ones. I'd have had something. You good. Hold on, let me. I wish this was vodka.
I feel like she's showing you as a little girl. You used to travel a lot for some reason.
Yes, lived in Africa and then lived in Europe, traveled everywhere.
Oh, wow. And she keeps mentioning 3, 3, 3. So this will let me know that there will be 3 kids under her. So I don't know if you have...
She was 3 of us.
Okay.
Me and my 2 brothers.
She keeps saying, I'm your guardian angel. I'm your guardian angel. I keep seeing a J connection. Okay. I felt like she wanted to talk about watching over this child, or I guess grandchild.
Mm-hmm.
Her...
What if I just take off running? J, that's my son, Joshua. And she was extremely connected to him, but she died when he was 6 months old, right before my birthday. As a young baby, and we have it recorded, he says, KK, he was talking to her, he's looking up. I was like, what? And when he was a little thing, I was like, who are you talking to?
Yeah.
He still talks about her like he knows her.
He sees her. She's definitely his guardian angel for sure. She's saying he's extremely smart, but he's going to be really good actually with music.
I took him to a class the other day, and the teacher was like, do you know your son can sing?
Now, what's up with the move or the house? Because she keeps talking about this house. I don't know if you're looking at a new house.
I'm going to take off my wig and hit you with it.
Did you understand that?
Yeah, I understand that very well.
She's excited about this house.
I don't appreciate you and my mama getting together, first of all.
Okay.
I don't like it, and you need to tell her to stay out of my business. She know I don't make decisions quickly, and now she done brought you in it. I am stressing over this house. I can't see nobody would know that. You wouldn't have known that. So I'm going to validate you right now.
Yeah.
You would not have known about this house and my struggle and looking for this house. That is like on the forefront. Okay,
she's
I'm going to get a house.
Now's the time. It's going
to
happen.
She is. Tell her I need over 3,000 square feet. I'd like a pool and a view. Tell her to talk to the realtors. Can you talk to her? Go ahead. Tell
her. She hears you. She got it.
Mama, you got that? I need you to make it happen. Okay, you done hit career house. You ain't said nothing about a man.
That's next year for you. You know, she's saying, take your time, take your time. She's
next
saying, you're
year.
Not quite ready yet. You're not
I
quite
ready
yet. I've
never been ready, Mama. Dang.
You move. She said you move too much by the end of the
is
year.
Is it going to be a man or a woman? Not that I'm into women. I got a lot of girlfriends, and I feel like I'm getting older. It's just going to be me and my girls.
I can tell you this, that he's going to be on your level. He's going to be, I feel like, around your age. Your mom is working behind the scenes, working from heaven with the angels to make sure that opportunity happens for you.
Oh, thank you, Mom. I need it, too. Oh, my goodness, great.
I hope that
Does that really help? Yes.
I feel like this deserves a hug.
It does deserve a hug.
I
you got to come
it.
Down here to me because I got to stay on camera. Hey.
No. That was a good reading. That was an excellent reading, in fact. And, you know, all that laughter and that joviality really does help keep the vibration high with that. But I like the way she's going to take her wig off and whack him with it. Great.
I'm still on the hay.
Yeah. I mean, I've never seen these two before, him as a medium or her show. I've never seen this. So this is a first.
Oh gosh, one. I can imagine what her show's like, Mike. Yeah. You know? Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, there are some characters that are out there.
Yeah.
No, it's all good and sweet. You know, I love it when mediums do come out with stuff that you wouldn't find just on Google or finding it in their trash can. Oh, I know that you went up to KFC last week, yeah. You know, because they found the receipt in their rubbish bin. You know, because a lot of psychics do that sort of stuff, yeah, go yeah. through celebrities' rubbish bins.
Yeah. well, this is also the trouble doing readings for celebrities, because as Teresa Capuccio has discovered to the pelters she's been given, you know, oh, it's easy to do research on Jim Parsons and da-da-da and da-da-da.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course it is. But what does it serve? You know, she's famous, she's wealthy, she plays to packed audiences. You know, it's so easy when you're at that level to be caught out. So you have to make sure that I think you've got to make sure you're the real deal, or you will get caught out.
That's right. Look at John Edward.
Yeah.
He got called out.
Did he?
He was giving everyone cards. They were just little cards, like this size paper.
Yeah.
And it said, your name, who do you wish to contact, any questions that you want for them. So all the cards went backstage and he saw them. So he'd know Linda was trying to contact her grandmother and ask, where did you find the $1 million, you know?
Yeah.
Where did you hide that $1 million, Nan? so he'd know Linda's trying to find her grandmother. Okay, I've got a grandmother here. She's telling me her granddaughter's name is Linda. Is there a Linda here? See how that's what John Edward was caught doing, in a nutshell.
I mean, also, for example, tomorrow I've got to do a reading and I know the lady, I know her name. And I know her family name, and I know the job she does. And all I have to do is go through social media if I want and find out a lot more about her and her family.
Well, that's right. Yeah.
But what purpose does it serve?
Well, let's just go there. I've done a couple of famous people's readings now. People in America, you'd know their names if you heard them, right? So, you know, I give them information and they just look at me and think, this is not something that would be on social media, or how the hell did she in Australia find this out about me in America? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I do like just getting those little confirmations in there, you know, I don't want to breach confidentiality at all, you know, but – there's just things that you wouldn't possibly know unless you're a psychic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I like doing, you know, giving those little drops. You know, how often do you hear the psychic say, oh, your grandmother's come through, she's telling you that she loves you, she's happy. Oh, I can see that she was a very loving mother. And then the person's there going, oh, my God, they got it so accurate.
Yeah.
But they don't realise that's just psychology.
And that's no information at all. I mean, that's okay if it's used in part of a reading to help the validation.
Yes.
But not that's too generic. Anyone of our age, the chances are your grandmother's going to be in the spirit world.
Just last week I was talking to a guy, he was a guy on Skype, I was doing Zoom, an interview, and he said, oh, what are you picking up on me? And I said, oh, I'm thinking about your 62 car in the garage. And he said, how do you know I've got a 62 in the garage? Now, I could have gone onto social media and found that, but I would not have found it because he'd only bought it the week before and had no photos of it.
Right.
See? Yeah. So there's that click,
you
know? So then I started telling him what was wrong with the car. And he said, how do you know what's wrong with the car? And I said, well, because your car is now talking to me, you know? So he thought it was all in the engine, but he had a lot of trouble at the back end as well, which I was and he said, how do you know all this stuff? So, you know, if we don't get our information, it's not like, okay, I'm going to tell this person about their grandmother, or I'm going to tell them about their car or their job or whatever. It's the information that comes through on the day.
Right.
You know, and that's why, you know, I'm pretty honoured that I do get repeat clients that come back. And every time the reading is different. You know, one time it could be about your health. The next time it's your job. And the next one it's your kids will come through. So we've just got to do that potluck, you know, and that's what people don't realize because they have these expectations of wanting my mother to come through type thing when it could be Uncle Bob that comes through talking about his kids who are your cousins. Right. And you're there like, I didn't pay for this. I don't like my cousins. You know, I didn't pay for this. I wanted to talk to my mother. But, you know, that's where we've got to take ego out of it. And just remember that it is messages from the spirit world, you know, so to be grateful if anything does ever come through anyway, you know.
And, of course, Linda, Uncle Bob coming through can be the link, the bridge that brings Mum through.
So, that's right. You know, how do you know?
And, that's right. And if you start all that negative vibe stuff, then you just make it disappear. Linda, I've got to go, but I tell you what.
I love you.
I want to leave a message for people because this has been nagging me. And when I get these nagging ideas that won't go away, for complicated reasons, I know it's not my thoughts. It's what spirit wants. And the message I want to bring to people is to listen to the whisper in the wind. Listen, learn to listen to the whisper in the wind because we're going to be receiving messages in the wind. And for those that can hear it, this would be a great way of hearing what's going on.
I was listening to you saying that. And, you know, we've got this cyclone type event here tonight in Brisbane. You know, the cyclone's way down south, you know, like 48-hour drive from here. But we had a bit of thunder and lightning just before. And just as you said that, this big gust of wind just came through my window because, you know, it's hot. And look, I've even had the fan here tonight, guys. Anyone, this is my Vanuatu when I went to Vanuatu. Every time we're watching a video, I've been airing myself and all my hair is dripping in the back because it's so hot here tonight. But this big gust of wind just came through when you just said that.
Right.
So that's why I just had that little moment.
So just take time to try and listen to the wind because that's where a lot of messages are going to be given to people. So
that's that was right. Pause and be aware of your surroundings, guys.
Yeah.
You know, just be aware of what is going on around you. Love all. Try not to hate because everybody's doing that now. You know, be original. Don't hate. Do something different. You know, be unique and say, oh, today I'm going to love.
Yeah.
You know, love everyone. Love. Appreciate everything, guys.
Yeah.
Stay safe until next week, guys. Yep. You know. We love yous all. Thank you so much for viewing again. And until next week, stay safe and stay well. And we'll see you next week.
Bye-bye, everyone.